Retro.
Hey, this is Catherine Tabor, Senator Padme Amidala from Star Wars The Clone Wars, and you're listening to Jay and Dennis on Podcast Stardust. Stay on the light side.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And it's time for our weekly look at Star Wars news. But before we get into that, Jay, you want to remind everybody where we can be found on social media?
Sure thing. Not news here. We are always on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right. The dish is aligned. The signal's boosted to maximum output. The shield is down. We are now broadcasting to the galaxy. So, the first story we have is in the realm of movies, and it is both a Star Wars story and not a Star Wars story. But apparently, back in the day, Zack Snyder wanted to make a Star Wars movie, and this was revealed in an interview that he did with Empire Magazine. If you are having trouble placing exactly who Zack Snyder is, think of him from the DCU. He was behind Man of Steel and Batman vs. Superman and Dawn of Justice and the Justice League movie. So that was him. But back when Lucasfilm was getting sold to Disney, he had an idea for a Star Wars movie that he pitched to Lucasfilm, and it didn't go anywhere. But the description, the quotes around this was that he wanted to have a movie that had no known characters, and it was probably going to be rated R with the action and stuff that he had in mind, which was pretty much a non-starter for Lucasfilm. But this concept has apparently been turned into a movie called Rebel Moon, which is coming to Netflix on December 22nd. So, first off, Jay, are you a fan of those DC movies? Have you seen them, or what do you think of Zack Snyder's work?
I haven't seen them, honestly. I've heard a lot about Zack Snyder, and it's funny because I was just talking to Colby the other day about how I used to be such a huge DC fan. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. Ever since, I think it like the last Batman that had Val Kilmer in it was like the last ones that I really watched. And of course, the Wonder Woman movie. But honestly, I'm not super familiar. But wow, this is, like you said, it's a Star Wars movie, but not a Star Wars movie. And has kind of a Star Wars-y sort of release date in December, which is ironic.
Yeah. And I got to say, I've not been the biggest fan of the Snyderverse, is what they've called it for his run on the DC universe. I only saw half of Man of Steel, didn't particularly care for it. I thought, you know, Batman vs. Superman was maybe a C, and the Justice League movie was not particularly great either. The Snyder cut that they released up, which was definitely more his vision, because he kind of had to abandon the project due to some family issues, was a better telling of it, but still not all that fantastic. It was like 4 hours. It was a really dense movie.
Wow.
But, you know, some other details about this, you know, described it as a seven samurai in space. Well, that's been done in mm-hmm. Star Wars numerous times. They did it in The Mandalorian. They did it in The Clone Wars. That's not exactly a new concept. Now, he did acknowledge that one of the reasons why he was thinking that is because he knew George Lucas was into Kurosawa when he was creating the Star Wars movies, and so this was an obvious reference here. But the description of this Rebel Moon is a space opera that follows a young woman living in a peaceful colony on the outskirts of the galaxy. She's given the task of finding warriors who can fend off an impending invasion by the despotic regent Belisarius. The cast currently includes Sophia Boutella, Charlie Hunnam, Jaman Hansu, Ray Fisher, Duna Bay, Jenna Malone, Staz Nair, and E. Duffy, and I think this is Michelle Huseman. So that sounds like it could be a Star Wars project.
Yeah.
I'm curious. I will, based on that alone, I would check it out. We'll have to see what happens when I see previews and such for it. But it seems like it could be entertaining.
Well, yeah, I mean, if it's sci-fi, you know, it's right up our alley for sure. And I'll definitely give it a chance. I was looking at a few of the images online earlier today when you had put this in the notes, just to kind of get a feel for it. And it does seem like a very dark, almost like post-apocalyptic kind of Star Wars feel. Mm-hmm. And I can understand why, you know, he wanted it to be rated R and Lucasfilm was like, nope, because that's just not what they do. But I love Jimon Hansu. And then Jenna Malone is another one. She was in The Hunger Games. So mm-hmm. I could really get on board with those two. But yeah, very, very interesting. But I'll definitely give it a shot. Why not?
Yeah, like I said, I'm intrigued by the description. I will wait till I actually see some sort of promotional trailer for it to make a final decision on whether mm-hmm. I want to watch it or not. But at the moment, it sounds intriguing. But I don't know, just the thought of Zack Snyder doing that. And I wonder what that would have meant for Star Wars and what it would have meant for DC. Because he wouldn't have been available for so many of those projects over the years.
So true. So true. Yeah, and I know a lot of times we've talked about the different directors and such, you know, that have expressed interest in doing something Star Wars. And a lot of them have been, you know, obviously brought on board. But perhaps this was just something that was just a little too, you know, off the acceptable path for Lucasfilm, obviously, that they didn't want to pursue it. And it sounds like it was kind of his brainchild that he didn't really want to budge on either. You know what I mean? Like he had sure. his ideas in mind, and then this is what he wanted to do. And so their paths just did not align.
Yeah. I mean, the quote that's from Snyder on this is, "I knew it was a big ask, to be honest, but the deeper I got into it, I realized it was probably never going to be what I wanted."
Right.
And he's right. Because as you were saying, they don't do R for Star mm-hmm. Wars. Right. The closest you can get to that is some of the Legends material, like Death Troopers, that book that we covered so long ago. That is the place for that, not live action. Because as George Lucas is always famous for saying, you know, Star Wars was made for 12-year-olds.
Right.
And that's not the R movie audience. And quite frankly, I could see it being a big hit for a certain section of the Star Wars fandom that would be into some sort of hardcore Star Wars like that. But then it would be off-putting for a lot of others that have come to expect a certain Star Wars feel. And that level of violence just that would come with R wouldn't be appreciated. And it would probably be confusing for people as well. You know, Star Wars is something they could trust when they went to the theaters that they could take the families to. But now suddenly there's an R movie? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could see why exactly. That would be an issue.
Well, did they say, was it in this article that Zack Snyder was quoted as saying that there would potentially be two different versions of this movie? Like there would be the rated R movie and then there would be one that was a little more toned down. Did I see that in this particular article or did I see that somewhere else?
I didn't see that in this article. What I did see in this article was that he initially turned in something like 176 page script that meant it was going to be a 3.5-4 hour movie. And so they split it into two and there's going to be two movies made out of the script that he turned in.
Oh, so we're okay. So maybe one of those is R and the other one's not.
Well, I think it's part one that we're getting this winter and then part two, which is the second half of that script. And I have no idea what that will be rated, will be coming out at some future date.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Well, then let's get into some High Republic news. We got an abbreviated version of the High Republic show. It was all of about 5 minutes and change, which was really a preview of what they were going to reveal at San Diego Comic-Con later this month. There's not really a whole lot to talk about from here. They kind of recapped a few things that they said at Star Wars Celebration, which they'd already done. And then they touched on the fact that we have the High Republic, whatever it's called, show that's aimed at toddlers that's come out. And then there was High Republic aspects to Jedi Survivor, but that was kind of said in passing more than anything. And then they mentioned that Lucasfilm is going to have a booth at San Diego Comic-Con and you can get High Republic stuff there, which probably means books and comics. And it'll also be the place where you can find the authors periodically signing, and that there will be a Lucasfilm publishing panel in room 7AB on the Friday of San Diego Comic-Con at 1 p.m. featuring some of the authors of the High Republic, as well as some other publishing announcements. But they're very coy about what those were since this was the High Republic show. Yeah, and so that it was mainly about setting up San Diego Comic-Con. They did get into some reveals like they do at the end of every episode of the High Republic show. And first up was that they revealed that they're going to reveal the cover of the first issue of the next volume of the High Republic comic by Kevin Scott at San Diego Comic Con. So, Jay, this is where I would ask you what you thought about the cover, but it was a black image.
Right.
So, not much for discussion there.
They revealed that they're going to reveal it.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, we were talking a little bit about this before we started recording, and I get it that, you know, they're trying to pump up what they're doing at San Diego Comic Con and, you know, tease and get people interested in that. But not everyone's going to San Diego Comic Con, and the other thing they revealed is that Buriaga is still alive, but they've been teasing that on social media for a week now, that we're going to get the answer whether he lived or not. And, you know, they're using like the back of milk carton images with Buriaga's image on it. And then, and did you really expect them to say, oh, he died in this after all that? It was just kind of, I don't know. But, and then his story about how he survived is going to be in that collection of short stories, Tales of Light and Life, that's coming out on September 5th, unless you're going to Comic-Con, in which they will have it available for purchase there. Which, fine, this is not the first time a comic or a book or something has been released ahead of the availability to the general public, but this is, you know, a month and a half before we're all going to get it, and how is this not going to be spoiled all over the place by the time the rest of us get to read it?
Yeah, that's a pretty significant time frame to have it out to those special people, the attendees, you know, before the rest of us get it. You're right. Yeah, it's going to be all over the place, I have a feeling.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I mean, the one really cool thing they showed us was the cover for Eye of Darkness, which is the adult novel that's kicking the whole thing off. It's being written by George Mann, comes out on November 14th. And it's got Marcion Roe sitting on his throne with Loden Greatstorm's lightsaber ignited in his hand. So that was cool.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think of it?
Oh, yeah. Really cool. And, you know, it just kind of harkens back to a lot of the images that you get of these leaders, these warriors that are just kind of, you know, relaxing on their throne, and very nemesis looking kind of thing. But it's very different from, you know, we were talking a little bit offline about how it very much resembled the Eye of the Storm comics, or the Marcion Roe cover for Eye of the Storm, where he's got more of a red background. And this one's definitely got that blue background to it. And, you know, some of the other differences is the lightsaber instead of the chain that he's holding. And we said he looked like the Thinker. I remember that in the Marvel comic, Eye of the Storm, as opposed to this one. So
yeah, Eye of the Storm number 2, to be more precise. But yeah,
there you go. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And I can't find it, but I know there's another image of him on his throne somewhere with a leveler in it as well. And it may have been on one of those YouTube videos they did to promote one of the characters or something like that, or it may have been on a comic. I just couldn't find that image in the time I had to look for it before we started recording. So it's a cool cover, but it's not entirely unique. I feel like we've seen a lot of imagery like that when it comes to Marcion Roe, but having him on a book cover will be cool. That's it. I mean, that's it for the High Republic show. And I'm guessing they'll be along a week or two after San Diego Comic Con with a wrap up of all the news that came out of that. But I'm just going to, you know, I try and keep things positive here on this show, but this was just disappointing, especially all of the buildup that they did to it on social media, just to drop this 5-minute promotional piece for what they're going to say at San Diego Comic Con, which didn't really say anything except for where to find them at San Diego Comic Con.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of production attention and, you know, whatnot in order to have just a 5-minute show, but maybe they just felt like they needed to have something out ahead of San Diego Comic Con, which now they have, but yeah, it didn't really do a whole lot.
Yeah, you're very kind to them. Just because I you know, it took 5 minutes, so it's not like it took up my entire afternoon, but I was making sure that I had time available to do that and to watch it and to get it into our news before we recorded this evening. So, all right, I'm going to stop being sour grapes about this whole thing. And I'm excited for Phase 3 of the High Republic. I can't wait to see the comics. I can't wait to read the books and get into everything else that comes along with that. You know, we got stuff coming up before we know it. It was September with the Tales of Light and Life. That'll be fun. And we'll be covering it all here on the podcast. But I don't know. I just kind of can't help but feel like was taken a little bit of advantage of for this. So,
understandable.
All right. Well, here's a story that actually came up next week, but I put it on hold and did not do talk about it in my little 10-minute news episode that I did last week because I wanted to get your take on this, Jay. But the dress that Carrie Fisher wore as Princess Leia during the throne room scene, or the final scene, which I guess was the victory scene in A New Hope, went up for auction. And it was expected to fetch up to $2 million. It ultimately did not sell because the highest bid was $975,000 and the seller's minimum price to sell was $1 million. So it didn't sell, but still someone was willing to pay $975,000 for that dress. Mm-hmm. What do you think about all that?
Oh, wow. Just wow. I know when we had talked about this story kind of coming up, it was, and by the way, really great job of holding down the fort while I was gone.
Thank you.
But you're welcome. It was just a couple of days out from the auction at that point. And so that's when you said, oh, let's just wait until next week when we can talk about it together. And I was glad that we did. But yeah, $975,000 for a dress is a lot, but you know, there's a lot of people that are out there with stupid money, as my husband likes to call it. And if you've got that kind of money and you're willing to pay for it, then hey, why not? But I just thought it was really interesting how it came to be. And apparently there was one dress made for the scene, and you know, with the budget and everything of A New Hope, that's completely understandable that that would be the case. And somehow it got shoved in an attic and was put into a burn pile, apparently, that was going to just be basically destroyed. And someone had recognized it and saved it and said, oh my gosh, you know, this is the dress. And then subsequently had a lot of professional people who were very good at fabric restoration and costume restoration that meticulously brought it back to life in order to be able to be sold at this auction. But apparently it's going to be more, they're expecting it anyways, to be more of a museum piece than an actual apparel piece. But I thought, did you see where they also said that it, the way that it was reconstructed was that it could be basically let out if someone wanted to, that was larger than Carrie Fisher, wanted to wear it. Did you see that in the article?
No, the only one I actually read was about how it did fail to sell.
Okay. Yeah. Because I was like so enamored with this. So I was reading a whole bunch of different articles. So it must've been one that I ran across. So yeah. So apparently you could size it. You could let it out a little bit if you wanted to wear it. And I was like, oh, that would be cool. But yeah, I don't have $1 million laying around. So that's definitely not going to.
Well, for the sake of discussion, pretend like you did. And it was stupid money that you could blow on anything you want. And you decided to purchase this dress. What would you do with it if you had it?
Oh my gosh. Well, I would definitely try it on and I would take lots and lots of pictures. You know, I would definitely post them on my cosplay account. but I would probably never wear it out in public, quite honestly. Mm-hmm. And it would be, you know, in a place of honor in, you know, a hermetically sealed type of chamber. Because if I had $1 million to spend on a dress, I could probably also afford a hyperbaric chamber to keep it in.
Sure.
But no, honestly, I would also probably, I would love to work with Rancho Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
In order to be able to provide the experience of being able to see it, you know, other and share it with other fans.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be something, obviously I wouldn't try it on, but it doesn't fit you. It certainly wouldn't fit me. but I would want it to be seen. And so my top three choices would be Rancho Obi-Wan, and you know, put it on loan there. George Lucas's new pop culture museum that he's opening, I think would be a good home for it. Someplace at the Smithsonian, with a stipulation that it has to be displayed. And if they're not going to just display it, then they need to send it back to me so I can find some other place for that it can be seen by the public.
Sure.
So you know, that'd be cool to do. Yeah. I think it would be a, you know, a nice connection that people could have with Carrie to be able to see that dress. So yeah, that's what I think I would do if I had that kind of ridiculous money to buy it and then decide what to do with it.
Yeah, for sure. I'd be very interested to know if Billie Lord had any idea this was happening. I'm sure she probably did. and, you know, what her thoughts on this would have been, you know, in terms of the sale of it, and, you know, if it's something that she would like to acquire.
Well, you know, typically the costumes and things like that are property of the studio. And so if she wanted to acquire it, she probably would have had to pony up for it just like anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. She's got so much other stuff from Carrie. It may not be something that she felt was as necessary to have.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not like the issue she was having with family, who she accused of trying to profit off of her after her mother, after her death. So mm-hmm. Anyway, all right. Well, we got one last story in this week's news. We were just talking about Jedi Survivor. And so this is on the realm of spoilers, this is about as minor as it gets. But if you haven't gotten to this far in the game, or you haven't gotten too far in the game, you know, you don't want to hear anything about it, then go ahead and just skip ahead a few minutes to the end. But were you familiar with the character in Jedi Survivor known as Rick, the door technician?
Yes. Yes, I was.
I thought for sure when I ran across this character the first time I was playing that it was a joke, or not a joke. It was an error in the game that there had been a boss by the name of this, and somehow I missed it. And I was just getting attacked by the scout trooper in its place. But for everyone who's going, huh, what's he talking about? Or you watch Jedi Survivor, or you play Jedi Survivor, you take on waves and waves of enemies in a hangar, including some dark troopers. And it's a very harrowing battle. And then right after it, you kind of go up an elevator, and there you are confronted by a boss who says he's going to essentially bring the pain. And it is a scout trooper. He comes running right at you. You get the full health bar, and his name is Rick, the door technician. You can kill him with a single hit. And yes. A lot of people have made torturing Rick their hobby. They will hold him up with force and throw him off of ledges, throw him into walls, make him float in the air, and all kinds of things, because it's just, he's really captured the imagination of fans all over the place. This little gag that they threw into Jedi Survivor, there's all kinds of fan art about him. I think you can find some fan fiction about this guy. But it was kind of a fun little moment in Jedi Survivor. Well, in an interview with IGN, Jonathan Wright, who is the lead encounter designer at Respawn, was talking about this character. They had no idea that he would get as beloved as he became. And they did throw him in there as kind of a recovery moment for the players after they get through this big harrowing battle and you don't have a checkpoint where you can save your progress, and then they throw a boss at you. And so it's just kind of a thrown in there as a tension breaker. But mm-hmm. I just kind of thought that was fun that they were commenting on that, and this character is taken off the way he has.
And what I love about this whole thing is just the ability to laugh at yourself. You know, here we're talking about this video game that's developed that obviously uses so much time, so many resources, a lot of money. And, you know, and yet they are putting this in there just for the sake of being silly. I mean, it's mm-hmm. very similar to, you know, it made me think of Adam Driver when he did Matt the Radar Technician for right. Saturday Night Live. You know, it's just kind of poking fun, but yet in a way that fans really appreciate. And he really has become like this little like cult favorite kind of a thing. And I've seen so many videos of play events with, like you said, like you can torture poor Rick in so many different ways. But, you know, that's actually genius on the point of Respawn and this game, because it's generating so much talk. It's generating so much fan interaction. I mean, like I said, you know, it's everyone is talking about it. So even though it's silly, it's a stroke of genius to put this in there, quite honestly. And I love it.
Yeah. And it doesn't really violate that rule about Star Wars comedy that we're talking about. You know,
not at all.
You know, it is, yes, it's funny and it's a little absurd that this guy is, you know, promoted as a boss and he runs up at you and has this dialogue about how he's going to take you down, and then you could force push him and kill him if you wanted to. Mm-hmm. But anyway, it's a fun moment. And if you get him in, just go out and go to YouTube and put in Rick the Door Technician, and you'll find some
it's
fun
true.
Stuff.
Yes, you will indeed.
All right.
I wouldn't be surprised if you're able to get like skins for him and everything, like at some point, or change up his weapons if you wanted to do something like that to change the difficulty of the boss fight. Who knows?
Yeah, it'd be fun if we get some sort of little 5-minute downloadable content featuring Rick the door technician
absolutely.
As an add-on to the game.
It's one of those fun things that's just, you know, almost like I said, like Matt the Radar Technician or Wilrow Hood, you know, something that just kind of sparks the imagination of Star Wars fans. And I can imagine, you know, that this would be a cosplay that I will be seeing at a con near me at some point.
Oh, without a doubt. Without a doubt. Yeah. I mean, it would be too hard for anyone who's already got a Scout Trooper uniform for the 501st to modify. So
exactly.
Okay. All right, then. Well, that will do it for this week's edition of the news here on Podcast Stardust. Thank you all for joining us. We hope you've enjoyed the episode. And if you did, then please make sure to like and subscribe Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. So I'd also like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from, we were just talking about it, DC and the MCU, Star Trek, and lots of other great pop culture topics. And as always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is you use, especially if that is Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay can remind everybody what those social media contacts are one more time.
You got it. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram very conveniently at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest page with lots and lots of boards and our YouTube channel, which does have all of our past episodes as well as some unboxing videos. So head over there, like and subscribe. And as Dennis was mentioning, there's lots going on RetroZap, and there is a Discord channel. So we also have our own room over on the Discord channel, so you can go over there and talk about everything with us over on Podcast Stardust and, well, Dennis, because I don't get over there very often. And there's also lots of other rooms, geekery topics going on as well. And we also have a Tee Public store. So if you are in need of a swag refresh for the summer, we've got 7 different show logo designs available on all kinds of products, from t-shirts and sweatshirts and, you know, coffee mugs and nice little water bottles and things to take to the beach. And that's teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. So with that, Dennis, what's going on with Warp Trails?
So Warp Trails is plugging along with our review of season 3 of Strange New Worlds. So if you want to hear my wife Beth and I talk about what's going on over there with Captain Pike, or the absence thereof, and the other characters, then just head over to the RetroZap podcast feed, which is the exclusive home of Warp Trails, and look for the Warp Trails episodes amongst the episodes of all the other great podcasts that are on the network. Jay, what is the latest with cosplay?
All right. Well, I am working really hard on my Hera upgrade this summer, and you can check that out over on j.stipscosplay. Been a little quiet here the last couple of weeks, just a lot of things going on, but I'm planning to post some things for some work in progress Wednesdays. I'm also still working on my original concept Mandalorian, as well as helping Colby with his 5th brother build. And you can also catch me as Hera from Rebels and Ahsoka from the Clone Wars and the 4th sister Inquisitor. So again, that's at j.stipscosplay.
All right. Upcoming on the podcast, we have our discussion of the season and series finale of Rebels coming up on Monday. And on Wednesday, we'll be diving into Disney Gallery, The Mandalorian, Making of season 3. So join us for that. And with that, that'll do it for episode 595 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have a great weekend. And until next time, may the Force be with you.